Thank you. Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Good morning. This is a beautiful day. This is the day that the Lord has made. And let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is a special Sunday, Mission Sunday. And we got lots of visitors from all over the place. So we are very happy to welcome. Gusto ko i-welcome ang mga RE students who are here. RE students, please stand. Under Reverend Fabula, Reverend Dr. Fabula. Okay. So thank you very much. Welcome to the University Church, Religion and Ethics students. Okay, you may now sit down. As you all know, we invite the RE students twice a year, no, to worship in the University Church, so that they will also be exposed to our culture, spiritual culture here. Kay taga CPU ni sila, no? This is also their church, and they are being invited to be part of the activities of the worship experience here at CPU. So, once again, welcome, especially for those who have come for the first time. And also, I would like to welcome a friend and a brother in Christ, Hiroshi Okamoto. Hiroshi, please stand, okay? So he's also wearing his attire, but he's from Kyoto, Japan, and he's planning to stay in Iloilo for many months, and he's very excited to be part of this church, especially joining in the choir, because he's a member of the Manila Glee Club. He's passionate about music, music ministry, and so my friend, welcome to CPU. And also, we got lots of visitors. I would like to welcome brothers and sisters from the Gideons. Manoy Ed Delio, please stand. Rogelio Limpoco and Lucia Limpoco, please stand. Welcome to the University Church. And also, Joel Gafate. Please. All right, at the back. Brother, welcome. Welcome to the University Church. And also, we got visitors from Manila. Actually, hindi naman yung mga bisita, no? Mga partner ni sang atong panimalay. But we are very happy that they could join us in worship today. Pastor Ruben Rimondo and Laura Rimondo, Joshua Rimondo, and of course, Nicole Dacquiado Rimondo. So welcome the Rimondo family. And of course, Nung Denzel, welcome back from Canada, Denzel, Dr. Denzel Dacquiado, and Marinel Lim, please stand. Okay, so welcome to the University Church. And we got people from Negros Occidental, Eunice Sacordet and Marilyn Basia. Please stand for you to be recognized. Welcome again to the Ato Segwa. Okay, okay. And I would like to welcome Pastor Larry Cue and family from Ahoy, Pastor Larry. So do kadamo kita siyang bisita, no? We are very happy to celebrate the presence of the Lord in worship with our brothers and sisters coming from all over the place. So once again, welcome to the University Church. This is Mission Sunday, no? A very special Sunday for the University Church. And so let us now prepare our hearts and minds to worship our living God.
Dong dong ay si dong ilay insinali dumaay 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 dong dong ay si dong
live a life of faith, walk in Shall we all rise? O give thanks to the Lord, call upon His name, make known His deeds among His peoples, sing to Him, sing praises to Him, tell of all His wondrous works, glory in His holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord in His strength. Seek His presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that He has done, His miracles, and the judgment He uttered. So He brought His people out with joy, His chosen ones with singing. And He gave them the lands of the nations, and they took possession of the fruit of the people's toil, that they might keep His statutes and observe His laws. Praise the Lord.
God is good, and all the time, amen. Shall we open our hearts and our voices as we sing and shout to our Lord, our God.
loving and God Almighty, God of all nations, yes, we need to shout the whole world that you are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. We thank you that you created us, you know and you love us. We are fully known and completely loved by you. Thank you. Though we fail you, you have never turned your back against us. You remain faithful forever. Lord Jesus Christ, praise you for your sacrificial love. You live the perfect life we could never live and died the death that we deserve so that we can be forgiven and live for eternity with you. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you convict us of our sins, assure us of your forgiveness, and empower us for our lives. Triune God, we glorify you today as we celebrate Mission Sunday, reminds us to completely trust you so we could share the message of salvation and expand your kingdom here on earth. Be with us now as we worship you and adore you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Okay, fine. Go back to your wife. That was the word of a girl to a salesman after having a bath. While the salesman is sitting on the bed in the hotel. And he saw a book on the bedside and it caught his attention. And opened it. And it was in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 4, which says, marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed be kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and the sexual immoral. Convicted by the Holy Spirit, he told the girl, what we are doing is wrong. I have sinned. We must stop this. And the girl said, okay, fine. Go back to your wife. And he packed her clothes and leave him alone inside the hotel. He keep on scanning the pages of the Bible. And it leads him to Romans 6:23, which says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ our Lord. Moved by the Spirit, he knelt down crying, asking for forgiveness of his sin. Lord and Savior. He returned to his wife and asked for her forgiveness. Now he is active in the church ministry together with his wife and his children. Because of that Bible placed in that hotel room by your missionaries, the Gideons. The Gideon is an extended missionary arm of the church, composed of Christian business and professional men, and we visited churches to report the Gideon's ministry. We are organized in more than 200 countries and territories around the world for fellowship and service. We believe that the Bible is inspired and infallible Word of God, and Jesus Christ is the eternal Son of God. We placed and distributed Bibles and scriptures in designated lanes and places in schools, hotels, hospitals, and nurses and medical personnel, in the fire department personnel, police, and the armed forces. And recently, we have allowed to distribute scriptures in church-related activities such as evangelism and the like, as what we did last Friday, the culmination of Christ Emphasis Week in the big field, and we distributed more than 3,000 copies of New Testaments to students and visitors. We are blessed as the student asked for a personal copy of Testament, especially students coming from Colegio de San Jose, University of San Agustin, St. Paul University, St. Therese College, and John B. Lacson Maritime University. We can tell that they came from this school because of their uniform. You see, here in the Philippines, it's easy to obtain a Bible, but hard to understand how important the Bible is to people in some other countries. In Thailand, children clasp their hand and bow when they receive the Word of God. In Ghana, one of the poorest countries in South Africa, a couple of years ago, a team of Gideons from United States distributed thousands of Bible in public school in 2 weeks. During the distribution, one of the classroom teacher said to the Gideon, "I am their English teacher. They will read this book and I will teach them English from this book." Since the founding of the Gideons in 1898 until today, 2.5 billion copies of Bibles had been distributed around the world in 110 languages and 750,000 dialects. In the Philippines, a total of 900,000 Bibles and New Testaments had been distributed during the COVID pandemic. I don't know how many received the Lord Jesus Christ, but statistically, 1 out of 10 received the Lord, and that is 10% to say. Right now, India is getting more Bibles than any other countries around the world. Only 2% of people in India are Christians. So the question to be asked, when are we going back? Where will we go next? Every time your heart beats, 2 copies of scripture are placed somewhere in the world. The need is very much greater. Well, you might be wondering how you can help. We have 4 programs that you can participate. First, prayer. Please pray for us for a steady flow of funds to print the Bibles and more open doors for distribution. Next, sowers of the seeds. God is calling business and professional men in this church to respond in the God's ministry, the Gideons. Don't you know that Iloilo City Camp, which started in this church, is the 8th Gideon camp established in the Philippines? You know, I am happy to see Sister Digna Gonzalez is here, and the other elderly sisters who are still active in participating the ministry of the Gideons. A couple of months ago, the Care Philippines visited here and distributed goods for the least privileged children, and Sister Digna stayed for the whole day giving testaments to these less privileged children. And even during the graduation of the College of Medicine and Pharmacy, only Sister Digna stayed for the whole ceremony giving, distributing the New Testaments to the graduates. So the challenge for you, brothers in this church, please reactivate the Iloilo City Camp of the University Church. Third, you can be a friend of the Gideon. You can give an any amount to the ministry on behalf of a loved ones during significant occasions in their honor for the printing of the Bibles. And lastly, if God would open your heart to this ministry, today we would like you to consider making a financial gift to the Gideons. It takes 70 pesos for the printing of this New Testament. To make its way to one man or woman or child's hand across the world. And 7,000 pesos for a box of 100. Which will be to be delivered to the country where people, much less to survive, to afford God's word. Our Gideon's Hotel Bible, what we are placing in the hotel, cost 350 pesos. And its average lifespan is long enough to impart 2,300 lives. Any help that you can give today is greatly appreciated as we continue to distribute God's word. Whether they are lost, alone, hurting, or just struggling to find their purpose, God's word is the right tool for the right job at the right time. I'd like to close by reading the passage in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 10 to 11, which says, "As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent." Thank you, congregation. Thank you, Pastor, for allowing us to share Gideon's ministry today in this church. Good morning, and God bless.
God's word gives us the basis for why we do missions. Prayerfully, please watch this short clip, which gives us why we do missions. It has to be from the Word of God, because that is our only anchor and basis. And we are glad that the Word became flesh among us, became a living Word, and He has given the command for us to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And here's the promise: I am with you always, even to the ends of the earth. Nothing compares to that promise we have in Jesus.
The Bible is an incredible text made up of 66 different books written by more than 40 authors over a span of 1,000 years. It is not just a compilation of a bunch of different stories or a self-help manual or even a devotional book. It is one cohesive story from Genesis to Revelation, the story of God's glory. Let's take a look at his story. In the beginning, God created everything for himself and his glory. At the pinnacle of that creation, he made man so that God could share himself with others. We were told to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth with the glory of God. But man decided that God couldn't be trusted, that he was holding something back from us. We decided to live for ourselves instead of for God, and this filled the earth with sin and selfishness. The generations of man had soon gone so far off track, in fact, that God flooded the entire earth and started over with a man named Noah. When Noah stepped off the ark, God told him the same words he had told Adam: be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. Once again, however, humanity looked to give itself honor instead of God. Because they all shared the same language, it was easy to communicate and cooperate, so they made a plan. At a place called Babel, they would build a tower up to the heavens, and in doing so, make a name for themselves. They labored to build their own kingdom rather than obey God's command. They had made the same mistake as each of the generations before them. Since mankind had ignored his message to spread his name and his glory throughout the earth, God took matters into his own hands. He scrambled the languages of the people so they could no longer communicate easily with each other. In that moment, God had formed the many different tribes and peoples of the world. So the different people groups spread to the north, the south, the east, and the west. Out of those nations, God chose a man named Abraham and made a covenant with him. God told Abraham that he would bless him and all his descendants, turning them into a great nation that would bless all the other nations. God eventually called this nation Israel, and he began to demonstrate his glory through them in many ways. He gave them a set of laws to live by so that they could live separate and holy lives from all the other nations. In doing so, they would become his royal priests, mediating between God and man. By living out his commands in the sight of the nations, Israel would encourage people to love God and love others. God also gave Israel a special geographical place on the earth, strategically located in the middle of all other nations. It was in this promised land that Israel would be a light to all nations, showing them the path to God even in the darkness of the world. Sometimes Israel would live out this calling well, understanding God's desire to bless all of the peoples of the earth through them. Other times, though, Israel would fall into the same trap that humanity had again and again, glorifying itself rather than glorifying God. When Israel got off track, God intervened. Sometimes he raised up prophets to remind them of their mandate to bless the nations with the blessings he had given them. Other times he would discipline his people by allowing them to be taken captive by other nations. Regardless, God used Israel, even in their disobedience, to make his name great throughout the earth. But all of this was just the beginning of what God had in store. In all of its ups and downs, Israel grew hungry for a promised Messiah king who would establish an everlasting kingdom that would never be defeated. That, of course, leads us to Jesus. God sent his son Jesus to earth for 33 years to dramatically demonstrate the Father's love for both Jew and Gentile alike. Yes, he was from King David's bloodline, but his genealogy had both Jews and Gentiles in it. His first worshipers were the wise men, Gentiles from the east. Angels proclaimed that his salvation would be for all peoples. Even his baby dedication identified him as a light for revelation to the Gentiles. Time and time again, Christ reminded his disciples, who considered themselves God's favorite, that God's plan from the beginning was to bless all peoples. His life modeled this message perfectly. He became angry when the temple wasn't being used as a house of prayer for all nations. He told parables about the kingdom of God being a kingdom for all people groups. And he preached good news to Jews, Gentiles, rich, poor, educated, and uneducated alike. Jesus served Canaanites, Samaritans, Romans, and Greeks. He was and is a true Messiah for all nations. He lived a perfect life, died a perfect death, and rose again with a perfect resurrection. Then he commanded us to go make disciples of all nations, the perfect words to sum up his ministry. He told us that this gospel of the kingdom must be proclaimed in all the world as a testimony to all of the ethnic groups, and then the end would come. We saw the beginnings of this when the Holy Spirit filled the disciples at Pentecost and told the wonders of God in all the different languages of the world. We saw it continued when Christ called Paul and other apostles to preach the gospel to the Gentiles. It continues even now. We are waiting for the end that we see in Revelation, when the Lamb of God, Jesus, has purchased with his blood people from every nation. Those people will form a multitude that no one can count, from every tribe, tongue, and people group, worshiping and saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." That's the story of the Bible, a single cohesive story from cover to cover. God's story, the story of his glory among all the nations. But it can't come to fruition until all nations have heard. He invites you into that story. He invites you into that mission. What part will you play?
God continues to invite us to join the mission. What part do we play? I'm glad that the University Church has been answering God's call to go out, spread the good news, and you are all a part of this. Here are what's been happening for the past year. We'll start. We are supporting pastors. Some of them are in the poor areas of Iloilo. We have there. Sorry, hindi ko kakita mayo. But these are all over Iloilo. Slowly, please. Yes, give some time. We have in Ahui or in Concepcion. We have in the mountains of Lambunao. We have in Pasi. We have in Leganes. These are pastors who receive less than 5,000 or 3,000 a month. And in a simple way, UC just sends some amount to help. But you will see their ministry there. So we can consider that probably as Jerusalem, Judea. Judea, malapit lang din sa aton. But some of these places you can say would be probably Samaria. We have even in Aripdip and Aligamot, that's in San Rafael, tunana sa bukid. So, Sok, if you can post kung makita mo na ang Aripdip kag ang Aligamot. We are supporting Pastor Marlon Brasileño there because he's doing an outreach outside of his own church. Okay. We also, besides the churches and pastors that we support, we have also supported Operation Jabez. That was last year. Some of our people, some of you here, were with us, and we went to Jerusalem, Samaria, Judea, the bigger and wider circle, because that's Antique in Lawaan, still sharing the gospel, still helping Lawaan Church to spread the news. And it was fun, but it was also arduous because we went to the mountains, just like our song, Go Tell It on the Mountains, that Jesus Christ is Savior, make Him your Lord. The University Church has also been active in helping those with medical needs in the community, like in Santa Monica, to sa city proper, lapit sa pier, where we had Operation Tuli, and so there was circumcision of the flesh. But before they could be circumcised in the flesh, we shared to them the gospel so that their hearts would also be circumcised. Little children being attentive and receiving Jesus Christ as their Savior. We also had in Pavia, same thing. Dari naman nga side. Before we could give them medicines or have them consult the doctors that are helping us, we share the gospel. Okay. When we were commissioned, and that commission is for all of us, it said, after receiving the Holy Spirit, start in Jerusalem. And here is our Jerusalem, CPU, the campus. And I'd like to call on Sir Lambert Baez, Dinka ng Lambert. Please stand, he's way back there. Ato sa likod. He is teaching the School of Evangelism, and at the same time, helping here in the campus ministry, our Jerusalem. Nangkristi Hotare, please stand. Nangkristi has been to the uttermost parts of the world, all those Kazakhstan, Stan countries with Muslims, but now she's back here, also doing the home mission back to Jerusalem, CPU. With her, helping her is a Donna. Where's Donna? Donna? Oh, where's Donna? Oh, there's Donna, right? She's also here helping here in the campus. That's why University Church, we thank God for your prayers, for your support, and your presence. But we want to invite and challenge more of us to be involved in obeying the Great Commission, which is for all of us. We even have missionaries being supported by us in the other countries of the world. We have Pastor Jose, Pastor Chris. See, Amera Shan is the sister of Pastor Chris with her husband, Jose, no? Ernie. They're in Cambodia, and they're doing a wonderful ministry there. Daisy Cardinal, one of our young people here before, went to China, but afterwards is now in Libertad Antique, and she is ministering to the young and old people in Antique. So kadamo sang aton nga involvement, kadamo sang ginagamit sang Ginoo nga aton mga people. And we just need to respond to that call of God to be involved. So when we call for a next school of evangelism, we'd like to invite those nga wala pa naka-undergo sining school of evangelism, where you will just be taught and brought to share the gospel. It was done in San Rafael. We'll trust the Holy Spirit to lead us where next to do this. But we invite you to join us. So far, those are what God has been doing in this church, through this church, for this year. All glory to God.
Thank you, Kidzone. May I request everybody to please rise for the reading of His Word. Our scripture text is found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. I'm reading from the New International Version. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, in teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the ages." This is the word of God. Please be seated.
Before I pray, I would like to request all the RE students who are here to please stand. RE students, please stand. I will offer a special prayer for you, and also all the missionaries who are here, those who are involved in missions, no, both foreign and local missions, please stand up. We'll have a prayer. This is Mission Sunday, so we would like to say a prayer for all of you. Let us pray. Our gracious God, who is the source of every good and perfect blessing, God, who is the creator of all the ends of the earth, we thank you for gathering your people in worship today. We honor you, Lord, because regardless of the circumstances that we are going through, maybe some are going through tough times, some are having some trouble and trials, some are enjoying the beautiful things that are happening in their lives. Regardless of our circumstances, you are good, and you are our God who meets us where we are. And so we thank you, Lord, that in this hour of worship we could lift your name on high, because it is your promise that once your name is lifted up in our midst, you will draw all people to yourself. We thank you, Lord, for the presence of these religion and ethics students who are with us today in worship. We thank you for their presence in our university. It is no accident that they are here, because surely you have brought them in this hallowed ground of Central. And so I offer a special prayer for them, that you will be with them in their studies, that you will sustain them, especially during tough times. Maybe some of them are on the brink of giving up. I pray that you will just sustain them with your strength, that they will be able to finish strong. And I pray that while at Central, an institution known for scientia et fides, knowledge and faith, and that's my prayer for them,
that while here at Central, they will not only apprehend knowledge, that they will not only be equipped in their respective fields of study, but I pray that they will also apprehend faith, a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, that they will put their lives on a firm foundation, and that is in our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray for their respective families, for your blessing, for your protection, and I pray for their parents and guardians. May you bless them, Lord, so that they will be able to support the students that they have sent to CPU. So I entrust them to you, Lord. Spare them from forces that will try to derail them from their dreams, from the beautiful future that you have prepared for them. Because for sure there will be lots of forces out there whose aim is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But you, O Lord, have come that we might have love, life, and have it more abundantly. Kabay pa nga amo iniiyang ma-apprehend sang amon mga estudyante. And so I entrust them to you, Lord. Thank you for the presence of missionaries. Thank you for raising up in our midst people who just love to respond obediently to your call to preach the gospel to many nations, to make disciples. Thank you for raising up in our midst people who just love you, Lord. People who just seek to obey you and to walk in step with your will. Continue to raise up in our midst people who have the heart for mission. And of course, this church always considers Central Philippine University, its students, faculty, and staff as our mission field. And so, Lord, continue to bless our ministry here in this church. I pray that you would bless, you would prosper the many ministries of the University Church. I now pray for the rest of the congregation. You know us through and through. You know us by name. You know our joys and aspirations and even our concerns. Maybe some of the worshipers here, or even those following us through live stream, are going through some tough times, trials. I pray that you would sustain these brethren who are going through difficult circumstances. We have members of our community of faith who are bereaved over the loss of a loved one. I pray, Lord, that your comforting presence, your sustaining grace, your presence, who specializes on restoration, should restore all forms of brokenness within us. I entrust you everything. Thank you, Lord, for your sustaining presence nga nagbuligid sa amon during Christ Emphasis Week. Thank you very much, Lord. And we can only imagine the things that you will do, beautiful things, beautiful plans that you have for those who heard the good news of salvation through the messages of our speakers, through our convocations. And we continue to cling to you, Lord, because we believe we are only mouthpiece, instruments in spreading the good news. It is the Lord, it is the Holy Spirit that prospers our work, that causes our ministry to bear fruits of righteousness and peace
and restoration. And so we entrust everything to you. Prepare our hearts and minds to listen to your word today. This is our humble and earnest prayer in the matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. You may all be seated. Thank you.
And I want to run where the angels come from.
Thank you, choir, for that powerful, powerful anthem, beautiful song. My task for today is also to introduce our invited speaker, who is not new to our community of faith, especially here at CPU, because he is a Centralian. Having graduated his degree in civil engineering at CPU. And he is also a certified farmer. He owns Efrata Farms in Badyangan, Iloilo. For those of you who have not visited the place, just come to me for booking. It's a beautiful farm. He is a chairman of the Board of Christian Disciples Missionary Church. And he is also the former national president of the Gideon's International in the Philippines. I just would like to express my gratitude to the Gideon's International for being partner, now for being my partner, you know, our partner here in our ministry at the University Church and in CPU. They've been distributing Bibles, thousands of them. During our graduation, now we last Friday. So salamat gid sa Gideon's International for your partnership. We can only imagine the thousands of pesos we will be spending if we will buy Bibles to distribute to our students, but they are kabay pa makaliwat. So he is the former national president of the Gideon's International in the Philippines. He is a member of the Board of Trustees and the CPU Corporation. As a matter of fact, he is the chairperson of the Physical Facilities Committee. Now, we have engaged so many meetings with contractors and committee members before we were able to finish this building on this side, the Christian Education Center. So he was very much involved in the construction of our Christian Education Center. Thank you very much, sir, for your service. He is also a member of the Board of Regents of ESAT University. He is married to Mrs. Rose Velado Cañuto. Please stand, Manang Rose, please stand. She's there. And they were blessed with three children and five grandchildren. And so let us now welcome in our midst our messenger for today, the mouthpiece of God, Engineer Ed Cañuto.
Maayong aga sa inyong tanan. And for those who are not Ilonggo, good morning to everyone. Pastor, I am so thankful for giving me the opportunity to stand before the congregation this morning to share the message that the Lord has impressed in my heart. And I would like to thank also Engineer Bettini Adimni, the chairman of the board of missions and evangelism, for this privilege. Truly, it's a joy to see you and to be with you. I'm inspired by the kids' presentation, and so with the choir. I remember days that we were involved in singing in the choir at the First Baptist Church, Haro Evangelical Church, and those were memories that the Lord has impressed in my heart. And this morning, I praise and thank God for what He is doing here at Central Philippine University, the different ministries that the university church is involved. Naka very inspiring, no? And the reason why I purposely did not prepare a PowerPoint for this morning, because we will be dealing with just three verses. And probably there are other few verses that we can talk about related to these three verses. Because I believe that with the Bible in our hands, and the truth that we'll be listening to, the words from the Bible, we will go out of this place blessed. So before we go to the message, let us bow down our heads in a word of prayer. Let us pray. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you for the Lord Jesus, who is our all-sufficient prophet, priest, and king. In his name we ask that you open our minds so that we can understand and comprehend the scripture. Lord, grant your servant the anointing that I can speak the word you desire your people to hear this morning. Guide my thoughts and put the right words in my mouth, that all spoken shall be for your glory and honor alone. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. The foundation of the message that we will be having this morning is found in Matthew chapter 28. This is the last command of the Lord Jesus Christ to his disciples before he ascended to heaven. And allow me to read these verses this morning, because we are going to focus and find out the truth that we can learn from this as people of God, as children of God. The Word of God says in verse 18, "And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Brethren, Matthew 28, 18 to 20 is a simple reminder to all of us that the church is on mission for the Lord Jesus Christ. We are not here as tourists, but we are soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are on mission. And the last command of Jesus must remain the first priority of the church: go and make disciples. You know, at this time when this was written, the last verses of the Gospel of Matthew, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus has already taken place. All that is left for Matthew's Gospel to report is the promise post-resurrection reunion of Jesus and his disciples. There was the report on verses 16 to 17. If we go back before these verses, amo ini ang setting sang ginhambal ni Jesus ining the last command that he wanted his disciples to implement. In verse 16 it says, "Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted." Some doubted. You know, the worldwide mission of Jesus, he wanted these doubting disciples to accomplish. These simple men, 11 of them, they are weak. They were doubting disciples, like just like you and me. There were no money, there were no programs, there were no churches, buildings. He changed these men to be witness to the world. And these disciples took this challenge very seriously. Sang ginhambal ni Jesus ini sa ila, seryoso gid nga ginpamatian si mga disipulo nga ini ang instruction ni Jesus. In fact, in the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 6, when these disciples were preaching the gospel to the Thessalonian people, they were described, these people described them as men who have turned the world upside down. Imagine, a doubting disciples, but they made a difference in the world in preaching the gospel. Today, brethren, I declare to you that the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ still has the power to turn the world upside down. Do you agree with this? Say amen. 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 Yes. Wherever you are today, God can influence and use you for the mighty work that he has prepared.
The Lord Jesus Christ is still willing to use simple, weak people like you and me to be His messenger, His witnesses in the world. In the world. But we must be on mission. We must not lose sight on what the Lord Jesus has called us to be and do. We must ensure that in our generation, the mission of Jesus Christ must be our top priority. The reason why some of the churches today are decreasing in numbers, because they have forgotten the first love of the Lord, winning others for the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, brethren, what does it mean to be on mission for Jesus Christ? Ano ang buot silingon? When we are on mission for the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 18, makita natin diri. Ang isa pa rason, the Lord Jesus Christ claimed that all authority has been given to Him in heaven and on earth. First and foremost, brethren, if we want to be on mission for Jesus Christ, first and foremost, we have to believe the claim that Jesus makes. And what is that claim? All authority is given to Him. For the record, verses 18 is not a commission, but a claim that Jesus told His disciples. And this authority that He has given His disciples, nobody can overrule. And not only that His sphere of influence, that His sphere of His authority is in heaven, but even on earth, His sphere of authority includes everything, both heaven and earth. In fact, the last encounter He has also in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the last encounter He has with His disciples. And what does He say? He said to His disciples, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to Me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Brethren, we were called by the Lord as His disciples to be messenger and witnesses to the world. I can imagine the very first American missionaries who came over to the Philippines, and for that matter in Iloilo. They named Charles W. Briggs. He started the work back in 1898, and he was partnered by a Filipino preacher by the name of Braulio Manican. And the two did a tremendous job. The passion that they have in their hearts to share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to people here, foremost in Iloilo, talagang ibang-iba. And in fact, they were augmented with another pastor by the name of Pimentel, a Tagalog who lived in Barota. This is where conversion of Philippine Baptist churches originated, from these men, great men, passionate men, to share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The result of their mission was Haro Evangelical Church, established back in September 1900. Kabalo ka mo, during that time, ang pinakamanami, ang pinakamaayong means of transportation ay paglakat. So kung gusto mo magkanto sa isang lugar, maglakat ka. Wala bisikleta, wala kabayo, siguro may iba ni may kabayo, no? Wala sing kotse, wala sing salakyan. No, nothing. But the passion of these people that God has called to become missionaries here in Iloilo, grabe. So that when Haro Evangelical Church was established in September 9th of 1900, they were not contented with that, they had to go out. And the first town that they visited is the town of Haniwai. They evangelized folks in Haniwai, and to cut the long story short, Haniwai Church was established. Kabalo ka mo sang unang ngalan sang Haniwai Baptist Church, Calvario Baptist Church. Ginpamangkot ko ang isa katigulang daw nakaagi sang pag-umpisa sining church. Siling ko nga ang Calvario. Kay siling niya ang description sa mga misyonero sang pag-umpisa nila sini, ang hisimbahan na sa pukatod.
daw masaka ka sa kalbaryo kung magkanto ka sa simbahan. Kag not only that, imagine walking from the city down to Haniway. 34 kilometers. Lakton nila para lang mag-evangelize. This is the passion that these men, great men of the Baptist, American Baptist Mission Society has placed among nga may mga simbahan kita subong. Kabalok na, may kalbaryo, but then they believe. Sila niya may pag-asa pa. There is hope that we can evangelize more. So they walk farther, 6 kilometers away from Haniway. There is the Tiniklan, Sitio Tiniklan. Oh, sila nila, there is hope. There is hope for evangelization, for mission activities here in Haniway. And you know what? They were able, by the grace of God, they were able to establish a church. Ano ang ngalan sang church? Good Hope Baptist Church. So halin sa Kalbaryo, nagbudlayan sila pag-establish, by God's grace, the church was established. Here is a good hope. And I praise God because just 2 months ago, 25 souls were baptized from that church. And the church is growing by the grace of God. Okay. Naguntat bala sila? No. They went forward. And another 5 or 6 kilometers farther is the city of Iniligan. And they shared the gospel in Iniligan. And again, the church was established. And you know what the church name? Forward Baptist Church. So halin sa Kalbaryo, may good hope, kag they went forward to establish more churches. And that was where Udyungan Baptist Church, Agusipan Baptist Church, Malublub, and the rest of the Baptist churches were established. This was the passion of our former great men here in Iloilo. You know, brethren, when Jesus claims all authority, it shows that nobody is above that authority, both in heaven and on earth. And when disciples of Christ decided to do and use that authority for the glory of God, miracles do happen. Our mission in the world begins when we believe the claim that Jesus made. He was given the authority of God, the Father, to execute divine sovereignty over all. And we thank God because from that first preacher, there were thousands of Baptist churches that were established up to today. Matthew 28:18-20 is a declaration of Jesus against all enemies of the cross. And the most pressing question then about the Great Commission is the personal one. How is this Great Commission affects you as a person? How is this Great Commission affects you as a believer of the Lord Jesus Christ? Siguro ang isa ka pamangkot is, how are the things today between you and the Lord? You know, brethren, the church is expected to obey the commission Jesus gives. And the singular imperative of the Great Commission is to make disciples. Is to make disciples. Amo ini ang tuyo, ang katuyuan sang Great Commission, that there will be more disciples that would come to the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. I was reading an account that in the world today, I think there are over 3.2 billion people who have never heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 3.2 billion. But when the church started to obey the commission of Jesus Christ, we can hasten and reduce this 3.2 billion. And that ultimately the disciples will become more like his disciple if we continue to do the work as a disciple making. Brethren, the assignment of the church is to make disciples, bring the gospel to the lost, for them to repent of their sins and run to the cross and trust the blood and righteousness of Jesus for salvation from God's wrath that will come. Then, when that happens, Jesus becomes not only the Savior of that disciple, but Jesus becomes the Lord of that disciple. Brethren, this is not a call for the select few, but this call is for everybody. Kita nga tanan, ginatawag sang Ginoo to make disciples. And this should be our top priority. So, in verse 19, the command is this: go and make disciples. Disciple making has to be a lifestyle where all of us are to make disciples. Oh, I thank God for my involvement with the Gideon's ministry. When you are, when I travel at any time, we have the Testament Bible. So, pag sulod ka sa parking, ang parking attendant, you can give the Bible. You can share the Bible. Pag nag-drive-thru ka sa McDo o nag-drive-thru ka sa Jollibee, ng attendant, you can give the Testament Bible. And let the Word of God speak. Why? Because we believe that the Word of God will not return to Him void. In Isaiah 55:11, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please and shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. The Word of God can make a difference in the lives of people. Now the question is, are we doing this? I was talking with the Pastor Chris here just a while ago, and you know, I was so impressed by what we are doing with the students. Imagine, we have over 16,000 students here at the campus. You know, siling sang atun foundation, no? Go, all authority has been given. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, of all nations. We are privileged here at Central Philippine University because instead of going out, going to China, Chinese come over. Instead of going to Korea, the Koreans come over. The Indians come over. And these foreign students that we have are potential for making disciples. Let me share with you our church in Las Piñas. It's alongside the Perpetual University, with over 16,000 students also. And we praise God because the owner of that school, Perpetual University and Perpetual Hospital, the owner of that school happens to be a member of our church. And we ask permission, Ma'am Daisy, pwede kami makabuhat sing campus ministry sa eskwelahan where it is accepted by the administration. And siya, oh, by all means. To cut the long story short, there were hundreds of Indian students taking medicine. There are hundreds of Nigerian students taking medicine. Just in less than a year, because of campus ministry, our church, about one third of the pews were occupied by foreign students. And they were passionate to learn about the Word of God. And praise be to God, because just the feedback lately, one graduate of College of Medicine from Nigeria and one from India, they reported that they are starting a church in the community that the Lord has placed them. So ini mga kabataan ngayon, isang una, they do not know the Lord Jesus Christ. But somebody made them a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is a challenge to all of us here. Maybe some years, we will have missionaries to China. We'll have missionaries to Korea because the students that we have discipled here at Central Philippine University became a missionary doing the work of the ministry. So we make disciples. Not only that we have to go and make disciples, but the Word of God says we have to make disciples by baptism. Go and make disciples to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. After we make disciples, we mark them through water baptism, showing the world that the old has been buried and the new has come. The call to baptism here is essential by the command of Jesus. It is our pledge of allegiance to the kingdom of God. We identify ourselves with the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is our statement of commitment to Christ, His church, and His call. Brethren, baptism does not save, but it is our first act of obedience to those who had been saved. the first act of obedience to those who had been saved. Siguro may pamangkot ako. When was the last time we had a baptism here at Central, at the University Church? It is continuing. Thank you very much, Pastor. Yeah, that is very important. So not only that we go and make disciples, not only that we go and make disciples by baptizing them, but we go and make disciples by teaching them. The Word of God says, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you. And what are we going to teach them? The lessons that we can teach them should come from the Word of God. Celine Evangelist thinks on, Bible is the basic instruction before leaving earth. See, we want to get instructed by the Lord. Study the Bible. Why? Because in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 to 17, this is what it says. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good works. Brethren, the challenge for today, what is the challenge for today? Since no one is exempted from this, this call is for everybody. Now the question is, how can all of us participate in this mission today? Well, exemption. How can all the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ participate in this mission today? Students, teachers, parents, elders, professionals, wherever you are, there are three things that I would challenge you. First, pray for the spread of the gospel to all nations. Prayer makes a big difference. Siguro pamangkuto natin ang aton kaugaling. When was the last time you prayed for the Muslims? When was the last time you prayed for the Arab countries? They are human beings and they are loved by the Lord. When we pray to the Lord about salvation for these people, the Lord will truly do wonders. And that can be part of our mission. Second, I challenge you to give for the spread of the gospel to all nations. Are you involved in giving offerings for mission activities? Let me share the church where I came from, where I'm the chairman of the board of elders and the church administrator. When we started the church, by the grace of God, back in 34 years ago, we prayed that the church would become a missionary church. And our mission targets are the unreached people of the northern part of Luzon, Kalinga, Apayao, Isabela, Mountain Province. And we prayed hard because these people never heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the church decided to start supporting missionaries that went to these areas to deliver the gospel to the unreached people. So the church decided to give 10% of tithes and offerings every month to the Lasan Tabo. 2 years after, the church decided to increase it to 15%. To cut the long story short, today, the church is giving 25% of the tithes and offerings that the people of God are giving Sunday after Sunday. And this is disbursed to the last centavo for mission support. You know how and what the Lord has done to this church? A small church of about 250 people. After 34 years, there were 22 daughter churches established because
the people of God are giving and supporting the missionary activities of the church. And not only the 22 churches established, but there are still an ongoing 5 extension church activities that the church is doing. We are giving glory to God because the people of God were challenged to give. Not only that they have to pray for the mission works, but they were challenged to give because by giving, they are blessed. Why? When you give to the Lord, you will never outgive God. The more you give, the more you will receive. This is the word of God. So if you cannot do already the missionary activities, walking and driving to a far distance to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, I challenge you. O kanami sa mga missionary activities, kag mga programs ni Pastor Sher, in a short time that we were talking here, I was so blessed because there are a lot of opportunities that we can do mission works here at Central, at University Church, starting from where we are, from the students, and we can expand. The report of Engineer Vitini, the churches that we are supporting today, oh, what a blessing that is. And this church, when they started also to give for the missions, I tell you, they will continue to grow, not only in numbers, but they will grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. They become stronger believers because they give. So brethren, the challenge is not only to pray for this and save for disciple making, but we have to give for missions. And if you are able, the third challenge is go. Go for the spread of the gospel to all nations. Kanami, may mga leaders kita diri. Oh, we thank God because there are so many campus ministries involved here. We have the InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. We have the Campus Crusade for Christ. And we have our own very own evangelism group here at Central Philippine University. Let us go. Those who can participate in these missionary activities, evangelizing people who does not know the Lord Jesus Christ, let us go. So pray, you give, and let us go when we are able. In closing, let me share with you, about 3 weeks ago, we left the house with senior citizens. Why? Because we are going to give out Bibles at Pasig City National High School. And the students are about 6,000 students. So at 5:30 in the morning, these elders, members of the Gideons, one is 83, the other one is 77, the other one is 73, and the youngest was 50. 8 of us went to Pasig. At 5:30, we were there, giving out Bibles. Every student that enters the school. And by 8 o'clock in the morning, we have almost 5,000 scriptures that were given. Praise be to God. Because that scripture, it is being the word of God, infallible, inspired, inerrant word of God, it makes difference in the lives of these students. So, brethren, I would like to challenge you these three. Pray, give, and go if you are able, so that mission of the Lord Jesus Christ continue. God bless you all.
Thank you, Brother Ed, for that powerful invitation and challenge. In response, let us now give our tithes and offering. There is a difference between planning and preparation. We can't plan the future that God holds, but we can prepare for each day by practices of generosity. Generosity helps us to forgive and to heal. It helps us to make peace in the world. It helps to bring justice and mercy to those in need. Our gifts this morning are one way we prepare for God's coming into the world in the most unexpected ways. Let's gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. Enclosed in your program is the special envelope for the Gideons. Please drop them in the offering pouch. And for those who don't have any envelope, please drop it after the worship service there at the back. We provided offering plate. Shall we now gather our tithes and offering? Thank you. Everlasting Father, thank you that you are the light of the world, guiding our steps on our path. Your word says that the earth is yours and everything therein it. The world and all its people belong to you. We recognize everything that we have belongs to you. We acknowledge that our very lives belong to you. We now offer back to you a portion of what you have given us. May God the Father prepare our journey. Jesus the Son guide our footsteps. And the Holy Spirit watch over us on every path that we follow through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Before I give time for Ms. Christy Hotari for our opportunities for service, I just would like to announce that after the worship service, we are inviting everyone, since this is Missionary or Mission Sunday, I invite you to visit our Christian Education Center. We have exhibits there coming from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao culture. You will be tasting lots of delicacies coming from these provinces. We invite you to visit because we have prepared some exhibits related to our Mission Sunday. So, gina-invite ko kamo after this. Damog in matilawan yung mga manamit, yung mga pagkaon nga gin-preparar sang aton nga Board of Missions and Evangelism and also the Board of Christian Education. So, visit ka mo after this, no? This time, I would like to give this moment to Ms. Christy Otari for opportunities for service. Thank you.
Before Manang Christy leads us in prayer, we'd like to appreciate Engineer Eddie P. Cañuto for his unselfish, wholehearted, and valuable service as guest preacher on the Mission Sunday celebration with the theme, Revisiting the Missionary Call, with scripture text on Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20. We give this on the 22nd day of October in the year of our Lord 2023 from the University Church of CPU. Signed, Reverend Chris Amorsolo Shan, our senior pastor, and me, Vitini Idem, as the BME chair.
Доброе утро всем. That means good morning in Russian. And somebody asked me what country itong dress ining nagasala akong dila kung Tagalog o kung Ilonggo. Kung diini naghalin ang ginasuksok kong abayo, no, this is from Tajikistan. And I have lived in the former Soviet Union for 15 years. And actually, sa mga ginpanghambal ni Manoy Ed, kag ni Nonoy Vitz, diri sa CPU nag-start ang kadamuan sa missionary call. No? And the University Church has actually supported me in prayer and in giving all through the year, those years, hasta subong. No? So, sa paglipanglakaton ko to sa mga iba-ibang na mga stands, no? Kag sa former Soviet Union, actually, upod ko kamo. Because you have given, you have supported in prayer, kag hindi mo lang na akong kisama mapanumdom, no? Nga amuna gali. I was your representative as part of the University Church going to all those places that have not been wala makatuan And ininga bayo, amo ni ginasuksok sa mga Tajiks every day. Tajik women. Actually, they also speak Russian. They understand Russian. But they speak Tajik, which is Farsi ang iyang base. And it's pareho na sila sang Afghanistan because they share a border with Afghanistan. So, ang hambal ni Manoy Ed, we start our missions here. But we also need to look beyond the shores of CPU sa mga kadamuan ng mga estudyante nga naga-stay diri no, naga-go through the walls and the halls of Central. When we leave this university, we go to different parts of the world. Ang isa sa mga privileges naton is that we are here, we can worship the Lord in all freedom. Pwede kita yaka share sang gospel, pwede kita maka-pray wherever, no? Diri sa Pilipinas. But there are other parts of the world where we cannot do that. So, maghatag tani sa introduction, may ara nga video that our video team will share before we go into prayer for the persecuted church.
It takes a lot of courage to be a Christian. Sometimes there can be situations that are unfamiliar, uncomfortable, even scary, but we can trust God's promise that He will be with us. We're reminded of that in Joshua 1:9, where God says, "Haven't I commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." God is with each of us, no matter where we are or what we face. And for some Christians, there can be a lot to fear. There are Christians around the world that face immense pressure for their faith, like in Nicaragua. The church there speaks out against injustice and human rights violations by the Nicaraguan government, and many provide shelter and care for people that protest the dictatorial regime. Nicaraguan Christians are standing for justice, yet they are met with hostility. And the government uses intimidation, harassment, and retribution to try and silence the voice of the church. It's like this elsewhere too. Christians in India continue to face very high or extreme pressure in all spheres of life. In recent years, there has been a big increase in the ideology that to be Indian is to be Hindu, and the impact of this is immense. Many states are implementing anti-conversion laws, which are often used to harass and intimidate Christians that are simply distributing aid or privately meeting as a church. The impact reaches into communities and homes too, with many Christians facing discrimination at work, losing their jobs, being excluded from society, and some facing physical assault. See, on top of immense pressure, some Christians face violence as well, like in Nigeria, where persecution is the most violent in the world. Christians there live under the constant threat of attack from different extremist groups and are often specifically targeted because of their faith. Attacks happen at villages, homes, schools, churches, and this trend of growing violence is spreading across the region. All of this pressure and violence means that following Jesus comes at a high cost for many Christians. In fact, there are 360 million Christians around the world that face high levels of persecution and discrimination because of their faith in Jesus. But yet, they don't give up on it. Through the help of the Holy Spirit, these Christians have the courage to rise above the persecution and discrimination they face. These Christians are our brothers and sisters in Christ, and they are incredible examples to us. Their lives are proof that our Heavenly Father keeps His word, that He is with us wherever we go and whatever we face. So on the International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church, let's stand with our persecuted family in prayer, trusting that whatever comes their way, God will be with them, giving them courage to rise above.
Yes, may God give them courage to rise above. Oftentimes, the plight of our other brothers and sisters who are persecuted are not within our focus or train of thought, nor the subject of our prayers, because of the busyness of our own lives, diba? But the truth is, around the world, there are Christians who are persecuted because of their faith. A quick search sa Google would tell us that there are at least 50 countries in the world where it is hard to follow Christ. And every day, there are 13 Christians worldwide who are killed because of their faith. Every day, 12 churches or Christian buildings are attacked. And every day, 12 Christians are unjustly arrested or imprisoned, and another 5 are abducted. Every day. Think about that. Last year alone, more than 5,600 Christians were killed for their faith. More than 2,100 churches were attacked or closed. And more than 124,000 Christians were forcibly displaced from their homes, and almost 15,000 became refugees. Because they love God, these brothers and sisters in Christ fear for their freedom, their safety, their lives. They lose their jobs, property, honor, and or family members. So let's be one with them and bring these brothers and sisters, the persecuted part of the worldwide church. Upod kita sinada sa worldwide church. Upod man sila nada sa worldwide church. And we are all part of this church. So let's bring them before God in prayer today. Let's pray. Lord, in Isaiah 41 verse 10, you said, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Lord, you are the protector of us, your children who enjoy freedom to worship you, but more so of those who have this, who do not have this freedom, our brothers and sisters around the world who suffer because of their faith in you. We pray for your protection for them. Protection to read the Bible without fear. Protection to gather as a church community together. Protection to share the good news with others. May they feel you holding them and journeying with them. Be with them, Lord. Give them your health and strength. Do not let them be dismayed. And do not let them come to harm. Also in Revelation 3:2, you said, "Wake up, strengthen what remains and is about to die." We know that in some countries, Christians make a tiny percentage of the population. In others, they have no way of knowing how many they are because they must stay secret. But we praise you that in spite of this, they still remain. Faithful God, you have sustained your church for generations. Continue to strengthen your church in these difficult countries, even in the midst of despair or persecution. Strengthen their faith. Strengthen their courage. Strengthen their numbers. May your presence be known in every country and your church rise up and bring you glory. We pray also for the organizations working to support secret believers. provide for these organizations through your people, and may they provide what the persecuted believers need so that they can be a blessing in the darkness. You also said in Matthew 5:44, as I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. As we remember in prayer those who are persecuted, we also remember those who persecute. We pray for the leaders of countries where believers live in fear. We pray for changes to dangerous laws, policies, cultures, and beliefs. Lord, you know that you can change people's hearts. Open these leaders' hearts and minds to hear your gospel, to know you, and to love your people. Where we find hatred, please bring love. Where we find fear, bring peace. Lord, make a way for your people to live in freedom. Likewise, in John 16:33, you said, I have told you these things so that in me you might have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Indeed, there are many troubles in this world, but you promise your peace and hope because you have already won. You have defeated sin and death. You have overcome the world. We pray that persecuted Christians around the world will know the hope that you give in every challenge, in every danger, in every moment of fear. May they remember that you have already won. You have already been victorious, and no evil can stand against you. Thank you for the courage and faithful witness of our brothers and sisters in these difficult countries. Give them tenacity to remain faithful to the gospel and to you. And we pray for the growth, as well as the growth of those who believe in you because of their witness. Lord, we stand with them today. Help us to continue standing with them daily, consistently, because we pray this in your matchless name, Jesus. Amen.
Please join me as we sing our closing hymn, The Song for the Nations.
Till the whole world sees the glory.
And now, may the words we have heard, the songs we have sung, and the prayers we have offered be seeds of transformation in our lives. May your love shine through us as we endeavor to obey the mission that you have entrusted to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.